At the time of recording this, Apple has released their latest generation M3 lineup for MacBook Pros just over 3 months ago, and not many people have upgraded. There are several good reasons for that. However, this review will be more focused towards software engineers who are considering getting a MacBook. Whether you're looking into the latest M3 lineup or to save some cash the previous generation M2, I want you to make an informed decision. Coming from an M1 generation MacBook myself and having used this M2 MacBook Pro over the past few months, I have few thoughts. The performance gap between M3 and M2 isn't even that high, so I was more interested to know whether I would notice a difference coming from an M1 to an M2. But I find it really hard to do these kind of comparisons by throwing some numbers around, by benchmarking how quickly Xcode compiles an app, or how quickly some apps runs on this machine, or what's the web development score this machine renders. Mainly because 95% of the software developers never really ran these benchmarks themselves, either because they never really cared about these numbers, or their machines were never really slow to run these numbers in the first place. So this review will be different from all the other reviews out there, including some of my past reviews. Mainly, I want to give two major perspectives. One for people who are still rocking an Intel machine. Two for people who have moved on to Apple Silicon already. And for whatever reason, if you're still watching this and you're not a software developer, you could still continue watching this because I'm sure there are a few things you can take away from this. So what's really new? The M2 Pro MacBook Pro is in every way an iterative release. That doesn't necessarily mean though there's little new about it. Sure, there is nothing mind-blowing about it compared to the M1 generation, but there are several things that may be potentially be useful to software developers and coders. I will not go into every aspect that have been updated but are not relevant to software engineers. Battery life, yes, it's better. You can get up to an extra hour of battery in this generation MacBooks compared to the previous generation. An extra hour may not sound like a lot, but at the end of a workday, you can still use that extra hour to commit and push your code. And if you have low power mode turned on, you can extend that battery life even more, especially on the 16-inch MacBooks. The benefits of low power mode is really noticeable on the M2 generation MacBooks compared to the previous generation M1. Better extended screen support. You get triple monitor support with HDMI 2.1 capable of running 8K screens or 240Hz screens at 4K. Let's be honest, 90% of software developers does not need more than two screens to do their day-to-day work. But for whatever reason, you're in the 10% or less who uses more than two screens. This generation MacBooks lets you do that with higher resolution and refresh rate. Wi-Fi 6E. Arguably not the most important update, but I wouldn't be the first software engineer having to download horrendously large applications and files. The faster the Wi-Fi, the faster the download, right? Wi-Fi 6E, provided the rest of your infrastructure is up to the latest standard, will enable higher wireless speeds up to twice as fast as before. Webcam and mics. This generation MacBooks have a slightly better webcam and microphone arrays. And let's be honest, even though this is not directly linked to software engineering, we do attend a lot of meetings and Zoom calls. So having a better webcam and microphone is definitely on that list. And on top of that, with the latest Sonoma update, you can also use your phone as your webcam, which gives you a much better camera quality. Apart from these updates, there are extra media engines, faster CPU, GPU cores, potentially faster SSDs starting at 1 TB, and other bits and bobs where certainly got an increase in performance. And these are performance gains that we don't notice on a day-to-day basis, so I will pass on them. What do I use it for? So to give you some context on what do I use my MacBook for and what kind of MacBook I'm using, The MacBook I have here is a 16-inch M2 MacBook Pro, which is a CTO version. CTO stands for configured to order, meaning this MacBook was configured to be a certain spec. So the specs I have is 32 gigs of RAM, 1 TB SSD, 12-core CPU, and 19-core GPU. And at work, I mainly work with enterprise applications. And the main focus is on Salesforce and certain integrations with external applications like SAP, Workato, and so on. So Salesforce uses a proprietary language called Apex, which is similar to Java on the backend. And on the front end, it uses a framework called LWC, which stands for Lightning Web Component, which is also similar to React. So these are the main tech stack that I work with on a day-to-day basis. And on the side, I do have some projects that I run on Node.js and a little bit of Python here and there. I don't work with any virtual machines, but I do some occasional editing on my machine. My choice of app is DaVinci Resolve. So for my YouTube and social media, I do some occasional editing on it. And most of the time, I have all of these tools open at the same time. And I don't notice even a lag, even when switching between any of these apps. In terms of tools for work, I mainly rely on VS Code. VS Code is my choice of IDE. And at all times, I have a couple of tabs open, both in Safari and Chrome, with at least one local server running on them. If you're still on Intel, if you're still using an Intel machine, it's very likely that you're going to keep your machine for a very long time to come. So switching to any generation Apple Silicon, let it be the latest M3 or the M1, is going to be a massive leap in performance compared to your Intel machines, as long as you go for a minimum RAM of 16 gigs. And before you even consider getting the latest M3 or the M2, it's worth taking a step back and reassessing your needs to realize that maybe most of these machines are way overkill for your day-to-day use. I'll be honest with you, the M2 MacBook Pro that I'm using is way overkill for my day-to-day use. You don't even notice a significant difference coming from M1 to M2, other than the aspects we mentioned earlier. Maybe few apps are rendering 10 to 20 seconds faster than the M1 generation, but on a day-to-day basis, this is not something you notice or even make a difference. But coming from an Intel Mac to any Apple Silicon generation is going to make that significant bump in performance. If you're already on Apple Silicon chip and you're considering going for the second generation or the third generation of these MacBooks, you might be one of those persons that needs that extra RAM, extra power, or extra performance that comes with these later generations. And you might not even want to watch these reviews because you already know that your workflow requires this much power. Having moved from an M1 Pro MacBook to an M2 Pro MacBook, I haven't even noticed any day-to-day difference. If someone gave me this laptop without telling me that it's an M2 Pro, I won't even notice a day-to-day difference coming from my previous M1. Of course, things are gonna compile and render maybe 25 to 30% faster, but even the previous generation, the compilation happens in seconds. So at what point does it actually matter? And this is why it only makes sense for larger corporations to invest in these generation MacBooks, because 25 to 30% faster means on a large scale, it does make a difference. But if you are an individual engineer or if you're part of a small team, it's really not that significant.